Live from a grungy kitchen table located in Annapolis, Maryland's scenic and historic capital, it's the Maryland Crabs Podcast. With each episode, your host, Tim Hamilton, John Frenay, and the occasional guest will dive in and pick apart the stuff that really matters most to you. We're too lazy to actually solve any of these problems, but we can definitely stir the pot. From schools, politics, parking in the fire lane, to those horrible people who drive BMWs. And here with this week's episode, live from the kitchen table, Tim Hamilton and John Frenay.
Well, if you listen to the Daily News Brief, you hear this voice every single day. This is George Young with DMV Weather, which is sort of undergoing a branding change. You're like DCMDVA Weather now.
That's it, right? So started with DCMDVA Weather. That was probably last year or so, right? So kept the, obviously that equates to DMV Weather, DC, Maryland, Northern Virginia.
Right.
And DMV has become and continues to become, I see it more and more with major media outlets. They refer to it as the DMV region. And so maybe I was ahead of the curve slightly, but...
Well, there's a confusion there because I come from outside of Philadelphia, and the DMV was Delaware, Maryland, Virginia, or the short for the Delmarva Peninsula.
Yeah, that's right.
But now you throw that DC in there, so it probably makes sense to...
And Department of Motor Vehicles, and right, so there's... But I think we've got some traction that's going to clarify, whatever. So I think DCMDVA Weather, you know, I made that switch to kind of clarify a little bit, and that's on Facebook and Twitter, and the app, you know, is the app name is DCMDVA Weather. In Apple and Google, but we'll see. I might make an overall switch to something new here in the short term called Weather Informant, but remains to be seen.
See how it goes. Remains to be seen. The intrigue continues.
That's right.
It is Thanksgiving when this is airing. We're recording it just a couple days before.
Yes.
And while you are eating your turkey, you're sitting on the couch trying to digest it.
Not working.
We wanted to talk about winter weather. I don't want to say we've been lucky so far because it's very rare that we would get any kind of real winter weather prior to Thanksgiving. We're still dealing with pumpkins and gourds and
that's right.
Nice fall weather.
Except last year, remember, we had a little inch and a half in the middle of November.
Yeah, but now we're getting to the point of where we may be getting into it. And as we did last year, I'd like to talk a little bit about what you see. And I know that you call yourself a forecaster or a guesser, whatever you want to call it.
I mean, all of the above.
Certainly not an exact science, but I'd like to, see what your thoughts are on the long range forecast. I know that the Farmer's Almanac, I believe, said it was going to be an average as far as snow goes, but it was going to be colder. And sometimes they're right and sometimes they're not. I mean, they've got 500 years of records that they can probably massage any way they want to make it look fine. But you're the one that's here in Annapolis. That's in Anne Arundel County, and we have a very unique situation, and I know that other weather people, I know Justin Burke has called it that, I know Tony Pan's called it, got the Annapolis bubble. You know, there could be a Category 5 hurricane coming right up here, and for some reason, we sit in this eye that it doesn't affect. And that probably, what's that for? Is that because of the bay?
You know, it's two things, right? The bay is a decent-sized body of water, so it has a little bit of a temperature gradient difference that it provides, right? So it could be, and really that's confined within a few miles around the bay, right? It really doesn't extend that far out into the county. I mean, it's colder, clearly, at BWI than it is at Annapolis on a daily basis, typically when you record temps, but a lot of other things go into play, right? So there's maybe some wind direction component, right? And so you get the one example, I think we've talked about it before, is the National Weather Service measurement system is right on the water in Annapolis, right? So if the water temp is warmer than the air temp, it might present a warmer day in Annapolis when a few miles inland, it's 10 degrees colder,
right,
and vice versa, right? So you have these little, micro effects. But in the end, for snowfall, if the dynamics are there, it's going to snow or not snow. You might get a little bit of an extra temp or two around the bay, right? Because the temp might be 40 degrees of water and 30 degrees in the air. But if the wind's coming off that water, it could warm up communities right on the bay to 32 or 33. So you might get some mixing. But for the overall winter forecast, I don't factor it in because it just doesn't do much. It does seem to present some kind of weird things on the map at times, the snow hole. But, that's also kind of put out there as the D.C. snow hole, right? The Capital Weather Gang refers to that all the time. And Tony Pan, he's and Justin Burke, right? Faith in the Flake. Flakes and Tony Pan's, you know, hashtag snow train, right? So everyone has their thing. And let's face it, Topper Shutt was kind of the original guy with the bread-o-meter.
Right? Oh, that's so, right. That's right.
So if it was just a little nuisance snow, it was one or two on the bread-o-meter. Don't go anywhere. But if there's a big nor'easter coming, you know, 8 or 10 on the bread-o-meter, go out and get all the bread and milk you can.
All right. I want to derail this a little bit here. Yeah. And maybe you might know this just because you've been in the weather thing for so long. The joke is it's going to snow. We need to get bread and milk and toilet paper. Where the hell did that come from?
You know,
do you know?
It just came from the, I don't know specifically, right? But it just came from the fact that you couldn't really get to a store because they just probably weren't that many ways to remove snow quickly, right? So whatever, in the early 1900s, you might have had to have walked a lot of times to a store and whatever. So it just became this thing. I don't know the exact origin, okay. but now it just doesn't pertain. You know, probably now you could order something on Amazon and they'd still have it to you within, you know, 24 hours or during the snowstorm, right?
So
it's almost a little bit, but it holds true, right? Everyone still says, oh, go, you know, and of course with memes circulating, right? That's one of the things that hits all the time.
It's amusing. I enjoy them, but I always laugh about it. It's, you know, trying to think back the last time that I was absolutely stranded and couldn't get to food, and I was clawing at, like, the, you know, eyeing up the cat to see whether, you know,
yeah,
whether,
right? You know. Plus now, I mean, the products last forever, right? Your milk lasts 2 or 3 weeks, or if you have almond milk or whatever, you know, it lasts 2 months. So there's just no need.
I apologize for getting off track. That just sort of came there, but we've got a winter coming ahead of us, and I know it's hard to forecast, you know, that far in advance. And yeah. I will say that you have been, aside from one time when you blew the forecast and you got all pissed off at me, and you know, but, you know, again, it happens. But I mean, if you sit there and I say 365 days, I mean, we just do the daily news brief every 5 days a week, pretty much. So, I mean, what, 250 times and you blew one.
And that was that last November, mid-November one, right? And, so, yeah, but yeah.
It's, and I'm going to say that's a pretty damn good record, okay?
I feel pretty good about it. It's been a good run, right? And the main thing, and that was a small snowfall. That was 1 or 2 inches early in the morning. And those are easy to miss, right? Because you might say, oh, just flurries or light snow. And what happened was we had a 3-hour period where it snowed moderately to heavily, covered the grounds. No one expected it. And, you know, it caused problems. So it did convey the wrong way. But what I've avoided, fortunately, and most people do, but sometimes you don't, is the big miss, right? Where you say, you know, 1 to 2 inches and you get 10 or 12.
Mm-hmm.
So that's every forecaster's fear. So, yeah, so far so good. And it's throughout the year, right? There's been accuracy throughout the year because everyone's attention is captured in some magical, emotional way with the winter, right, and snowfall and what they used to do as kids and the holidays and everything. But, you know, outside of that, I mean, the forecasting of lightning and thunderstorms is, in my opinion, way more important and dangerous and everything. And so that's the other 9 months of the year. But it's the magical 3 or 4 months, right? And so that's what we're upon, right? It's Thanksgiving.
Well, I agree. With a snow event, you know what's coming for the most part. I mean, this is not something that, like a tornado, that all of a sudden just happens to form and boom, it's there. And you have time to prepare either to buy your milk, toilet paper, and bread, or you know, hunker down at home, or just prepare your home and you're able to sit in there.
That's it.
Typically, with some of the storms we've seen, and it has never been evidenced any better than in Ellicott City,
yeah,
you know, you get a severe thunderstorm that comes in, and next thing you know, we've got people dying and businesses that have been out of business.
That's it. Yeah.
You look at that, you look at the water spouts, you look at all the different things that can happen in the summer. I know we had which actually was sort of the start of your business, is with the derecho.
Yeah.
You know, several years ago, that put a tree through your house.
That's right.
And, you know, winter is a little bit easier to deal with, I think.
Yeah, you still have, you know, you still have your surprises sometimes, right? The big surprise, we just passed Veterans Day, right? So it was the Veterans Day 1987 storm, and that was a 1 to 2 inch forecast, and it was 10 to 15 inches is what happened. And it was because it was just a miss, right? But it was a lack of technology, and that was the next year is when Doppler radar was introduced, and that was a game changer. And that's why the radars are called WSR 88D, right? So it's Weather Service Radar,
right.
1988 Doppler, right? And that came after that. So that allowed us to see more things coming at a longer range. And then even in this area, January 25th, 2000 was another big miss, right? This was a 1 to 2 inch forecast after the advent of Doppler and advances in technology. and Arundel, Maryland saw probably 15 to 20 inches of snow, right? The Annapolis area was a big deal, right? So these things still happen, but they are few and far between at this point because snowstorms are, you can see them coming, right? And they're typically region-wide events, right? The hard thing with thunderstorms is one major thing happens over Ellicott City or Catonsville or Annapolis or wherever, sure, and 10 miles away, it doesn't rain at all, right? So these are very mesoscale kind of things, right? Very confined, whereas a snowstorm typically is the region, right? And so you can predict on this wider scale, and you can see it coming for a couple of days. It's a nor'easter, or it's a cold front with low pressure, or it's a, you know, an Alberta clipper, whatever the case is. And as we all know now, the models are out there, and they go out to 10 to 16 days out, whatever one you're using. And so a lot of times you can see them way too far in advance, and it causes confusion and everything.
Right? Well, I think also we live in an area where the modeling works, if you will, and you can say it's going to be in a fairly wide area, certainly for snowstorms. I know my daughter went to school down in Appalachian, North Carolina, yeah, and she said it was, you know, you might have 10 inches of snow at school,
right,
and the professors are calling, going like, well,
right,
there's nothing on the ground here, and I live like 5 miles from campus.
That's right.
Just because of the mountains and the way that...
That's it. I'm familiar with that, right? In Boone, North Carolina.
Right.
It's way up there, and same for me was in Asheville, North Carolina, so weird things happen in those climates, right? But we're on the east side. The problem we have is elevation change, right? And it's the fall line is what it's called, the East Coast fall line. And it's just the way that shaped the structure of the country, whatever, thousands or millions of years ago when, you know, some shelf in the Atlantic came up and against the mountains. So you go from Ocean City to then all of Eastern Shore is flat and it's a different soil type and sediment. Then you have the bay, and then even here, we're still low level, but then very quickly, this is why I-95 is the dividing line, typically between snowstorms, is this fall line, because it is where people could not navigate rivers up falls and large cliffs. So this is why the East Coast is established basically along I-95. And it's where you have great falls in Virginia,
right,
and the falls in, you know, the mountains. Right. And so this is why it quickly goes up to a different environment in Baltimore County and Howard County, and then certainly in Frederick and Western Maryland. Right. And that's the challenge here, is that rain snow line every year. It's the same thing. So for Annapolis, it's not really the bay. It's more the topography and the fall line.
And 95.
Really 95. And you get air masses that come together, right? Warm and cold still in the wintertime, but obviously more cold. And that's the key ingredient. You need cold first and then moisture to make the snow. And it just is where that dividing line sets up, mainly because of the elevation. I mean, you just go up 500 or 1,000 feet in Frederick and Western Maryland.
Different ball of wax.
Yeah, different ball of wax. And let's look at even Baltimore County's a little more unique than Anne Arundel County, because you can be right, you know, Catonsville and in that area southwest of Baltimore, and it's a little colder, right? BWI mm-hmm. is colder than here. But then Baltimore County goes all the way to the PA line, right? So they can have 10 inches of snow in northern
That's
Baltimore County.
That's the Hartford zone.
Yeah, right? And so there's that whole northern section of Maryland that is just colder, right? It's just because of the elevation. So you have to factor that in. But you're looking at larger air masses and where the moisture is coming in. And every year, right, we just see where that setup comes, especially if it's an Alberta clipper, it's bringing colder air. The system's coming in from the northwest. But when you have a coastal storm, everybody wants the nor'easter. It presents problems as much as it presents an opportunity, because the counterclockwise flow of that system coming up the coast is bringing in air from the southeast, typically putting moisture over top of cold air that's already in place, especially if there's a high pressure to the north. It's the air flows are kind of competing, cold air at the surface, warm air up above. But, you know, so it just depends, right, how much warm air. And that's why you have to look at not just what's on the surface, where are the high and low pressures, but there's highs and lows and middle and high latitudes. And you need to know not only the width of the country, but the vertical stack, too. You need to know what's in the upper atmosphere. And that's the challenge.
Well, as you forecast, and we've got the different models that you look at, and you obviously, I think, past history plays into it as well. I mean, how do you come up with a forecast, whether it be for sunshine in 80 or, you know, 12 inches counting?
Yeah, for sure. You know, it's a combination of knowledge, experience, kind of instinct, intuition, and then, but it's also science, right? I mean, you have to know.
So you've got some gut feelings in there too?
Has to be, right? Yeah. Because you have to say, I see what all of these models are saying, but I've seen this happen, and the term in this weather community, right, would be analogs, right? And I'm sure it's used in other industries, but, you know, what are the analogs? Which is to say, what was the result when this scenario presented itself in the past? And you can use data to go in 1954 and 78 and 2012 and whatever, this exact scenario on paper 3 days ahead of time presented itself, and the outcome was this, right? And so sometimes you look at all of that stuff and you go, no, I remember that one storm where this presented itself and it turned out this way. And look, you can either be a forecaster that plays it safe and you just, it's called model hugging, right? You just ride the model and just regurgitate what it says, and most of the time you're right. Or sometimes you have to step outside and be the contrarian, not just to be the contrarian, but based on what you think is going to happen, and you make your forecast, and it's different from everyone else. And it's one of the best parts of doing this because, with, you know, of course, this is being posted on the DMV Weather app and Facebook and whatever, and sometimes National Weather Service will say 1 to 3 inches, and so will every other, you know, professional forecaster on TV, and I'm different because I'm not on TV, but I'm just as accurate, whatever, and I might say 4 to 6 inches in every year. It's what are you talking about? No one else is saying that. I'm like, great, let them say what they want to say. This is my forecast. And sometimes you just have to kind of deliver your own thing,
well,
right?
You
and
to...
it, in the end, it pans out or it doesn't, you know?
Well, what is the difference? I mean, I hear you talk about models. I mean, I've heard you talk about like the Euro and the NAM maybe, or the, mm-hmm. you know, all these different models. I mean, what is the difference between them, and why would we care?
Yeah, the difference is really kind of...
And what does Europe know about our weather anyway?
Yeah, right? Their computers know a lot, and so
yeah,
does
they're
their,
over here with their... We were here last week with their British aircraft carrier.
Oh, that was really cool. No, so all of these, right, the Euro, the EMCWF, or whatever the full thing is, and the NAM is the North American model, and GFS, Global Forecast System, all these different models, right? And so they're just systems of giving you simulations of what's going to happen, right? People do it in sports and business all the time. You're just simulating end results, and it's just they have a different formula, right? Math and science. And behind that, just it's not just the math and the science of the formula, but it's also, this is a key thing, it's the computing power and the newness of their technology. And so one thing I've read recently, I knew this before, but it was a little bit of an eye-opener recently, is the Euro has just, the EMCWF, it's this body of that is the Euro model, right? They have just put way more money into the infrastructure that produces the Euro model. So they have bigger and better servers, and they have more. So they're able to crunch more data more quickly, and they have more observations. So they just have more data, they crunch it faster,
okay.
And they're getting better results. It would play the same way out in business or otherwise, right? Like, how did we not see this coming? Well, we only have 3 computers and 2 employees, you know, versus the Euro. They just have more, they're putting more at it. So this is where we're falling short.
So all these different models essentially are, I'm going to say, for lack of a better word, companies that one of the products they produce, I'm sure they do more, is a weather forecasting model. And that's where the name comes from, the Euro, the NAM, or whatever it is.
Yep.
And obviously the larger the company, the more resources they can put into it if they figure that their product is viable.
That's it, right? And yeah, companies, right, is really what it equates to because it's a product. But these are typically governmental agencies, right? So the JMA model, the Japanese Meteorological, something like that, right? And so every country, or the Euro is a conglomerate of countries coming together to forecast. Because let's face it, I mean, the weather impacts everyone on a daily basis. So it's really important to know what's going on and to be as accurate as possible, not just to be on TV or radio or the daily news brief or whatever, but it's important to get it right because it protects property and lives and money and all of that stuff. So the Euro is just more accurate because they've put more into it. It's that simple. So, but the reality is that it all goes into this overall thing, right? It all goes in. So you have to take all of it as a forecaster. You have to look at all of them and then use your own experience, knowledge,
right,
and everything,
right,
to come up with something that is your own forecast, right?
Right?
Sometimes you're right and sometimes you're wrong.
Well, let's talk about your own forecast. Let's get into it. We're coming into winter. We're not calendar winter yet. I think we got a couple, about 3 more weeks for that. It's what, like December 21st or 2nd, I think?
Yeah, so meteorological winter starts December 1st, and calendar winter is the 21st or the 20th or 20th,
right.
Whatever, when the sun passes.
Right, the Tropic of Capricorn. Or
yeah, something. That's it.
So what are you looking at for this winter in the long term?
Yeah, so
and we promise not to hold you to it.
Well, don't hold me to it, right? No. So it's I think it's going to be another average winter. Last year was pretty average.
Man, I'm bummed.
We predicted an above average, thought that it would be a big El Nino winter, which is warming of the sea surface temps in the Pacific, and that would translate to all this other stuff happening. And it panned out that we just got a bunch of we had one decent snowstorm. But everything else was kind of 1 and 2 inches and whatever.
Those are the ones I hate.
Right, because it's still 2 hour delays of schools and a mess. And so it played out to be a pretty average winter in terms of overall snowfall compared to average, right? So the average in this area is about 15 inches of snow. Same for DC, Reagan National Airport, BWI is 20, Dulles 22. So I think what we just lacked last year was one thing, right? It was that one 10-inch snowstorm that everyone wants, the one good one. And that's the fine line that we have here between, oh, you had an average winter, or no, that was a good one, because one storm can really make it a good winter, and two big storms, and it's a memorable one. So anyways, that was what happened last year. This year, you know, all indicators of those things, sea surface temps and whatever, it appears to not be anything. It's not an El Nino year. It's not a La Nina year, which was cooling of the Pacific, whatever, right? And so there's no real thing that stands out that's going to say, oh, it's this or that, right? And so what I've looked at, two things so far that intrigue me more than anything, it's just kind of what's called the blob. It ends up this warmer area near Alaska. And so you look for this, and if you get the blob, right, and the blob is currently in place, Alaska's been pretty warm, it tends to help drive maybe some colder air into, because it sets up a block over that region, helps drive colder air into the central and eastern U.S. And again, without cold air, you're never going to get snow. So you have to look for the things that provide cold air. The second factor that contributes to that is snowpack. So when there's snowpack to our north and our west, then that helps keep the temps colder. And then as air moves, storms move across it, they stay colder, right? And so we've already seen a fair amount of snow in the northern plains and the upper Midwest and Canada. So you have this warmer air over Alaska that's creating maybe a block of some sort. You have a fairly decent amount of early snowpack in the northern U.S., not so much the northeast yet, but a little bit. But that doesn't matter. It's what's upstream, right, from us, which is there's snowpack in Illinois and North Dakota and South Dakota and Montana, whatever. So these two things help me give a little bit of hope to the fact that if that continues, then that first key ingredient will still be in place, which is cold air. And then invariably, we're going to get systems that come across. I mean, there's going to be moisture. I mean, it's just the way it is, right? It's all a matter of the temps. And so if we can just get that colder air, so with no real big low-hanging fruit kind of, hey, it's El Nino or La Nina, and it matches up with these years, then you kind of have to look for some other things. And those are the two things that I've identified so far. So I think there's going to be a decent amount of Alberta clipper storms. I think we'll see a bunch of 1 to 3 inches because of that cold air in place in those regions. But let's face it, it takes that one storm with the right amount of cold air for 6 to 12 or more hours. And next thing you know, you, instead of a normal winter, it's a blockbuster. And that's all we want. We haven't had that one big storm since 2016.
One thing I was going to ask you is whether there is a thing. I know we hear of like the 100-year floods and 1,000-year floods and all those kind of things. And I know that's not tied to, okay, well, we're at year 999.
Yeah.
But, I mean, do you find in the records that you've kept and in your experience that you've seen that, you know, every 5th year is a blockbuster, every 6th year or 3rd year or whatever?
For sure, right? It's about every 4 or 5 years it seems like it's played out, right? So I could go back as Blizzard of 79, 83, 87 veteran, you know, there was a blizzard in the winter of 87 in February, 87 November, and then there was one in 96, right, a big one in early January 96, right. Then 2000, right? So it seems like every 4 or 5 years, right? So we got And again, that's on average. We had the 2002, 2003 was great, big President's Day blizzard. And then, you know, of course, everyone remembers 2009, 2010. That was the all-time seasonal record. We, you know, whatever we had, 50 or 60 inches, something
right,
like that.
Right, right. That was when we had the three back-to-backs, right?
Well, we had the big one in December and right before Christmas and then back-to-back blizzards in right. the same week in February. And it all added up to just, it was ridiculous, right? And, but it was great,
too. It was
too.
Awesome. Shut down the world for a couple of days.
And shut down the world for a couple of days. And then really after that, I think 2013 into 2014 was a big winter, right? Then since then, nothing except we did have that maybe really kind of one of the all-time biggest snowstorms was January 23rd, 2016, something like that. It was a big nor'easter, right? It just played out. And that was one you could see coming. You know, you really could see it 5 days out. And look, no one's betting the farm or their life savings or whatever on any forecast 5 days out. But that was one I know specifically, and I'm sure people were like, A, who is this guy? B, he's crazy. But about 4 days in advance, I said, here comes 24 inches of snow on this day. And it ended up 26 to 30, right? And so 2 days out, everyone could see that. It just played out. But it was just those right things, right? So it was that instinct, intuition, and I've seen this before. There's a storm in the Gulf of Mexico. There's a large dome of high cold air, high pressure to the north. This thing's about to match up. But as we know, right, a little variation in storm track, 100 miles one way or the other, you're busted, right? And so that's where you still get surprises in the short term. You know, just a storm track, a storm follows a path, and you don't really know that exact track until after it's done. But any little deviation is a big deal in terms of what temperature you have, right? So a little storm track to our east, and it draws in colder air, and we're at 29 degrees, and just at us or to the west, you know, it might pick up a little extra warmth from a relatively warmer bay and all this other stuff. And we're at 34 and it's a nasty rain. So, about every 4 or 5 years. So where we're going with this is we're due, right? We're due for that. We're due for that big one, I think. So, but you can't right. call that out in advance, right? You have to look at the bigger players and say, the jet stream and the sea surface temperatures and, you know, whatever. And I got this email from Santa and he told me it's, you know, lock, right? You know, so those things. So I think for the most part, everyone's kind of on the normal. Everyone was pretty bullish last year. Everyone, you know, the pros around the region. And it's been a mixture this year. There's a little bit of some forecasts out there for above average. There's a bunch of people saying average, right? And so everyone's just
the sky is falling predictions from anybody so far this year.
There's nothing that it's going to be a record, but maybe there's been some 15 to 25 inch ranges versus let's say 10 to 20 is going to put us right in the average, you know. Right, so I think we're going to be right around 15. It's just if we get an extra clipper or two, that could add 2 to 6 inches to the end,
right?
You know, but I think we're going to be 15 or so. And again, the caveat to this every year is we just need that one, right? So that's the fun part is to track. And, you know, of course, you invariably see the everyone post that thing 14 days out. Look what's coming on the, you know, whatever model.
Right, right.
Right? And it's fun to see that. And it has its value, right, just as a signal. And then the signal has a little more trustworthiness at about 10 days. Then at about 7 days, it really is of value, right? It's something you should start to really kind of say,
sure,
hey,
well,
that
morphs from a, hey, just keep this on your radar, figuratively speaking.
That's it, right?
And then, okay, you really need to pay attention to this to
Go get your milk and bread, because that's right.
Okay, so we're looking at an average winter, you think?
I think an average winter. And at this point, temperature-wise, I mean, it's been a cold November. We're about 5 degrees below average for the whole month, which maybe four. That's statistically kind of relevant, right? For, you know, it's just been chilly, right? But last November was chilly, and then whatever. You get your swings, but temperature-wise, let's face it at this point, it's going to be warm all year long. We're in a different planet at this point, right? The 2019 is probably going to rank as the second warmest global temperature, right? And it is what it is. I think the last below average month might have been last November, and then this will end up below average. So You know, it's no one's predicting a colder than average winter. Maybe it will be. We probably had one within the last 10 years. Maybe it was 2014 or 15. It was pretty cold, but still. So we should expect average to above average temps. I mean, this is just the standard. Everyone can say that at this point.
Interesting you talk about that and the global warming and everything else. I mean, do you see a time, perhaps not in our lifetime, that snow in the Northeast is eliminated out of the forecast?
No, it's actually kind of the opposite, right? Because here's the deal. With a little bit of warming to the overall global atmosphere, what it means is that the atmosphere is retaining, then if it's a little bit warmer, it can retain a little more moisture, right? And so you're still going to get that cold shot. So with more moisture in the air, with a cold shot, you might tend to get, right? So this plays across all of these things, right? People are saying hurricanes are more powerful now because sea surface temperatures are warmer and there's more moisture, right? And really, it's playing out. In the last 5 years, there's been a Cat 5 storm. Not that it's hit land every year, but it's the first time in history that 4 or 5 years in a row, there's been at least one Category 5 hurricane each year. This year, it was a non-issue topic here, but just a month or two ago, the furthest east and north in the Atlantic that a Cat 5 storm formed, and it was Hurricane Lorenzo. No one here even knew about it because it was hundreds of miles out there. It might have barely grazed Bermuda or the Azores or whatever.
But it formed.
And that's important because it shows that far out in the ocean, it's even warmer because it takes heat to form these things, right? Uh-huh. Same thing with these floods, right? How does not just Ellicott City, right? So they had 2,000-year floods in a 3-year period, 2016 and 18, right? But the point is these thunderstorms now even have just a little more moisture to them. So I think the idea is that it's warming. And there's more moisture content in the air, but you're still going to have cold. And so I think we're going to see as much snow, if not more, over the course of time. So it's almost this like inverse relationship, kind of weird, right? And we're seeing it here in Annapolis. There's no denying anything. The water floods downtown Annapolis.
Sure.
Way more than ever, and it's only going to increase for various reasons. There's more water in the oceans. Things are melting. It's it is what it is, right?
It is.
And so this is Annapolis and, you know, Charleston and Savannah and Norfolk. I mean, it's Boston. I mean, all of these places, these things are not only coming true, but they're happening way faster than anyone predicted. And we're in for a different climate, right? And it's just, it really will cause more extremes because there are different factors coming together that are just producing bigger tornadoes and bigger hurricanes and hopefully this winter a bigger snowstorm, right?
I hope so.
Yeah.
I want to see it shut down for days and days.
Just
one or two of them. That's fine. I don't need these 4 or 5 little 1-inch, 2-inch BS that just causes a hassle. Hey, question for you, though. As you go, what can the average person do to prepare for winter? I mean, do you have any tips as far as, I'm going to say, you're venturing to say, don't go out and buy snowblowers.
Yeah.
That, you know, usually happens like the day before, but
yeah, right. It sure does.
But are there some general common sense things that we may not know about to, you know, prepare for winter, whether it be your house or yourself? Or
I think the common sense things are really have that little kit of some sort in your car, right? Have some kind of hat, gloves, blanket, whatever, because you never know when you're going to be out on the road and wow, just 3 or 4 inches might occur, or it could be a major snowstorm and you just never know. You're driving late at night. Could be a breakdown, right? And so if you're out there, could be a breakdown on just a really cold, clear night, and you don't want to be trapped somewhere and unable to get help for hours, whatever, somehow your cell phone doesn't work and it just doesn't pan out. And then the next thing you know, right, you're in very cold, dangerously cold temps, right? So the common sense, and just put it in your trunk or backseat, you know, that's kind of the thing to have is a blanket and some hat and gloves, maybe an extra sweatshirt or whatever, just those things and whatever else goes with that, right? I don't know, you know, some toiletries or whatever, right? Milk and bread in your car,
a bar,
right?
Yeah, some kind of a snack bar or something.
That's
like
right,
that.
A full bar as well, you know, some things. So, but otherwise, for your house, you know, I think at this point, just have a list of people that can help you shovel some snow or a snow removal service, right? Because some people clearly can do it yourself, but it is a strenuous activity, and when our bodies are cold, we're at risk in a different way, and this is why people die in the wintertime shoveling snow.
You're right. That is one of the more strenuous activities that we don't realize, okay? Now, I probably incorrectly still consider myself young and fairly capable.
That's what happened.
But you hear all the time from the hospitals and the doctors and the EMS people that, you know, these are seemingly in good shape, in good health type people that are dropping over. So really, when you're snow shoveling, don't overdo it. And that's a great idea to have, you know, somebody, you know, whether it be a neighborhood kid to help you out, or whether you've got a brother-in-law or something like that can come over. And two heads are better than one.
Two shovels are better than one. And with Facebook and everything, I mean, it's just so easy for 8 million different apps out there to have, you know, the local high school kid or even middle school or whatever, right? Or a landscaping service that does snow removal. Just let them knock it out for $20 and be gone, right? You know, I think you pointed out recently there's even places that offer snow insurance, right? Pay us X number of bucks, and they'll come out, and, you know, these things are good to have, right? You know, just in case, because it's just not worth it. It's the same as cleaning leaves out of your gutters, right? Let someone else do it, because, you know, you've lived your whole life, you've worked hard, you've saved money, you've gone to school and everything, then you fall off of a ladder because you thought you were, you know, still 21 years old or whatever. And at a certain point, give it up, you know, let other people do it. And otherwise, you know, have the service come out and check your chimney and all of that good stuff to stay safe before you keep, you know, start using that for, and we've probably already started in this month. I mean, it's been cold, so certainly that's the thing. But otherwise, I would have the kit in the car. I'd just have a go-to list of who I can call and then do some basic kind of prep things in the house of really clean the chimney and make sure that's good to go and have it tested. And then just
hunker down
wait
and
for it, right? Wait for the onslaught of models and memes and everything else.
Well, I'll tell you, last year too, and this is actually kind of neat, the city of Annapolis has the GIS department, and they've got real-time updates as far as where they stand on clearing streets. Yeah. The county has a similar one as well, but the state rolled out a program and an app called STORM, which is Statewide Transportation Operations Response Map.
Yeah.
Because they like acronyms.
That's right.
But what that does is the snowplows are equipped with sensors, and they're gathering, obviously there's some GPS, so you know exactly where a snowplow is, and these are on state roads.
Yeah.
But they're gathering information that's useful to you, surface temperatures, wind temperatures, you know, air, wind speeds and everything else, and reporting this back. And this app that you can download on Android or iPhone, or you can go online and get it, will actually give you an idea of exactly where, what's happening in your specific area. I mean, you may not have a state road where they're plowing it immediately to you, but you can get an idea there. And it's really kind of a neat app that the state's developed.
It is a cool thing. It's a nice service.
And you can go to, probably search just SHA and STORM, S-T-O-R-M. Yep. And it's a pretty cool thing.
And two things with that, right, is the chart system, right? So coordinated highway, whatever, right? Another acronym. And that gives you a ton of live highway cams. So nothing better than actually seeing the cam to say, no, the road's clear. I can see it, right? Goes with the STORM thing is information.
Yeah, but the cameras don't get black ice.
That's true, right? The cameras don't get black ice. So the other thing is really the Waze app, W-A-Z-E, right? Because it's crowdsourcing and people put in, hey, you know, this road's fine, or watch out here. You know,
everybody hates Waze right now.
Why?
Because they're with the Bay Bridge backups. Waze is sending everybody into neighborhoods.
Yeah,
and they're all
understood.
Like, and they want Hogan to go to I think Google owns Waze at this point.
Yeah,
and say, hey, you know, no, this is a long term thing. You've got to keep them on Route 50 and just tell them to hunker down.
Yeah, that's true. That makes sense. It's still good, right? But yeah, in this area for sure. but those kinds of things, those informational sources, and then again, it's the Facebook pages and stuff, right?
Right.
It's different form of crowdsourcing and people saying, hey, back up here, go this way, or
what's happening in your neighborhood.
And of course, the daily news brief.
Yep, you can do that.
We'll let you know.
Okay, I'll tell you. Thanks for the shout out and the pimping out there. But let's talk about you. Where do we get a hold of everything with all George Young?
Yeah. All right. So the website for DMV Weather is dmvweather.com.
That makes sense.
Yeah, it makes a ton of sense. At this point, Facebook and Twitter are DCMDVA Weather, right? So it's Twitter handle at DCMDVA Weather, and Facebook's the same thing, right? It's facebook.com/DCMDVA Weather. And then in the Apple and Google App Stores, really the best thing I think that we have to offer is our app, which is, I love it at this point. I actually use it as if it's not even my own app. It's pretty good. And that's DCMDVA Weather, and Google and Apple app stores, and it's free. Get it while it's free, because I'm probably about to start to charge for it. So
I've got it right here, and if there's a camera in that microphone, you could see it.
That's right. And look, so it's a mixture of everything we've just talked about, John. It is some model information. It is some custom, you know, forecasting information for me. It's some public domain stuff, right? It's National Weather Service and National Hurricane Center and all this good stuff, right? It's a really nice mix of different types of information, weather related. It's satellites and everything. The key thing is that there are push notifications that come directly from me. And so here's the key thing in any weather is you need to get it directly from a human, because any other automated iPhone weather app or whatever, they're all junk, because they are based on models. They pull data from data and push data out to you. And there's no human that interprets it and shapes it and corrects it, right? And so,
and it's also taking a snapshot of one particular location. As you mentioned, at the Naval Academy, they have a weather station that, you know, could be there, and that could be far, far different than anything you might see either, even in Annapolis, or certainly up at BWI, or out in West County in Odenton.
That's right, right? And so you need a human involved, right? And so it's two kind of, I'll say they're trademarked slogans, just because I put TM on the end of it, but it's always stay weather informed, which is the message I like to convey. But every day, right? Always stay weather informed, because you have to know what's coming. But it's also, the other one is weather for humans by humans, right? And so that's the thing, is you're not just getting an app with information, you're getting an app with information that's interpreted and delivered to you then by a human that can say, hey, watch for this. It's going to come in around 3 to 9. And really, that comes with pretty much every morning I send out a push notification that says, here's what's coming, right?
Right.
And then if the day is active, I'll push out more things. If not, I don't want to overdo it. So you just get the one, and then you, the next morning you get one. But it's 7 days a week. You get every morning between, I don't know, I don't do it too early. I don't want to ding you with your phone and have it beep and wake you up. But, you know, it's typically between.
Yeah, when that comes out, George.
It's typically between 6 and 8.
Turn those notifications off, and they start coming in at 4 a.m.
That's what happens, right?
Unless there's a tornado
It's a big deal, right? But it's typically 6:30 to 8 a.m., right? And then if things are active, you get updates accordingly. And really, that is the deal, is push notifications from a human, and not really anyone else is doing it. And I have other weather apps, and some services don't have weather apps, and most of the TV stations do, but they don't really send out, you know, they want you to view their show on TV because of advertising, because that's their revenue, and they don't want to just give you the information with a push notification. They do some automated things, but this is my key differentiator. It is from a human to you as a human, and you can connect with that. And you can message me directly, right, through Facebook or Twitter or whatever. I even had it through the app, but I turned it off. It was probably a little confusing, so it's now just a one-way push. But you can communicate with a human to get so. In the last couple of days, I've been going back and forth with one DMV Weather user. Hey, I've got a roofing job that's coming up, and what's it look like? And here you go. I think this is the deal. So
buy the stuff. Don't use it yet.
Free consulting, right? And so it's just direct stuff that you're not really going to get anywhere else. So that's what I'm building on, and that's it. And other than that, have an internship program with my college, UNC Asheville Meteorology Department, and it's legit. Have some soon to be meteorologists that help me kind of forecast at times, and just had our first my first intern that I worked with. I got a call from the CEO of a weather company in Kansas City called Weather or Not. Hey, I'm looking to hire so and so. She did the internship with you, and I said, oh, she was great. And she's now a functional meteorologist at this. This is her first job out of college. So it's even more, right? It's kind of trying to build some kind of minor league system here.
All about the human effect.
A little bit, right? So trying to make it more than just the basic weather stuff.
Fantastic. Well, I can't recommend dmvweather.com. enough, or DCMDVA Weather if you're looking on the app stores or any of the social media channels. I would certainly sit there and say, and if I had to guess, it's 250 forecasts you did for us last year, and when you messed up on one of them, that's a damn good record.
I feel good about it.
We look forward to it.
Looking forward to it too, and we'll be on it 7 days a week, and hopefully we'll get that one big one.
Okay, well, and on a personal note, I do hope that you're dead wrong on this forecast. I want to see couple 30-inch snows.
I'll take it. I'm with you. Thanks, John.
This has been the Maryland Crabs Podcast with Tim Hamilton and John Frenay. Sure to follow them in all the regular places, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and online at themarylandcrabs.com. Take a moment to rate us on iTunes. Now, get the hell out of my kitchen. Seriously, go!
You're still here? It's over. Go home. Go.